Okay, recording is started. Let me get my presentation back up here. Okay, let's talk about mobilizing your ministry, getting ready for the mobile revolution. I have to backtrack here. When I was in Dallas, Texas for the Christian Leadership Alliance Conference, I attended seven different webinars, one of them specifically on mobilizing your ministry, but almost, I would say, it was five of the seven webinars or seminars I was in. Spoke to or directly addressed mobile technology in some way. I'm aware that mobile use has been growing, but I wasn't aware just how quickly it's coming upon us. So I thought this was a important topic for all of us to get to. So there's another little window in my way here. Okay, so what we're going to talk about today, we're going to talk about the state of mobile industry, so I can get you all up to speed on where we're at with what's happening in the mobile industry. I want to look at preparing our websites for mobile viewing, and after the first section you'll see why that's so important. We're going to talk about cell phone applications, and that might seem like a weird topic, but I want to put that in there, and also talk about QR codes, which if you haven't heard about QR codes, this is like the new hot technology for probably the next 2 years. And the cool thing is, it's pretty inexpensive, so it's pretty easy to deploy. So Let's talk about the mobile industry, where we're at. Now, for those of you who are into technology like I am, you may be aware that 2008 saw the first time that laptop purchases exceeded desktop PCs. We were becoming a more mobile society, and that people didn't want to be tied to their desktops, that laptop prices had come down enough and had enough capability, horsepower and accessory-wise, that they could now really compete with desktops, and corporations were seeing the advantage of their employees having the ability to take work to different locations. So we're 3 years past that point, but what's interesting is that within the next year and a half to 2 years, we're going to see the number of people who access the internet from mobile devices, which is cell phones, smartphones, iPads, is going to exceed the number of people who access the internet from desktops, laptops, and TV sets. So that's why I'm saying that the mobile revolution is coming. Just a quick note, I've had a couple more people join here. I've unmuted everybody. If you could go ahead and mute your phones, all of you, or your microphones. If you have a question, go ahead and unmute and jump right in with your question. Otherwise, please mute your phone so we can filter out the background noise. Okay, so the internet is going mobile. Who uses mobile technology? According to Nielsen Media, they're the ones who do the TV surveys and whatever. 223 million mobile phones are in use in the United States by people age 13 or over. And now that's a big number, but it's an even bigger number when you realize the population of the United States is 307 million, which means pretty much every man, woman, and young adult out there has a cell phone or smartphone of some kind. So again, the mobile revolution has started and it's swelling. Of the 223 million mobile phones out there, 93 million are smartphones. And just to define, I'm going to define smartphones and feature phones. Feature phones are basically those that allow you to make phone calls, that can maybe take pictures, that you can download to your computer. They allow you to keep track of your contacts. Smartphones, though, go the next step. Smartphones allow you direct access to the internet, not just text messaging, but surfing web, sending email. They also usually contain a GPS location service so that you can use that information in your cell phone as well. More than a third of the phones out there are smartphones. And of those people who have smartphones, 16.7 million of them use their cell phones to access the web on a regular basis. 35% of adults have an application, one or more applications installed and in use on their cell phone. And like I said, we're going to talk about applications later. And, usually this stuff, when we talk about technology, for whatever reason, it affects, urban and suburban areas. But I wanted to let you know that I did some research, and of course I lost the source, so I can't put that up here for you. But I found two websites that basically state that rural adoption of cell phone technology is the same or very similar to urban and suburban areas. So while a lot of rural areas still don't have broadband access, hardwired copper and fiber optic, access through cell phone towers, though, is pretty much the same as anywhere else in the country. So if you're living in a small community, a lot of this internet stuff may not have seemed relevant, but with this mobile revolution going on, people are going to be coming to your websites sooner than you think. So how to make your website mobile ready? You've got three choices. And first I want to show you why you need to make it ready. I mean, we've talked about, you know, the mobile revolution is here and it's pretty much going. But I came up with this graphic. Here's the EPC website with a screenshot that's taken from my desktop. And that's how it looks in my web browser. And then this is a simulation of how it would look on a cell phone. So as you can see, websites don't view real well on a smartphone unless they're optimized for the smartphone. As an experiment, and I heard this analogy more than 15 years ago, it's still valid today, and I'm repurposing it, but if you want to get an idea of what it's like to look at a website on a smartphone, grab a toilet paper roll and try reading a newspaper or a magazine through it, and you'll get a real quick sense of the frustration of trying to view something designed for a large desktop monitor and now trying to view it on a small telephone or smartphone screen. So, and like I said, this is just kind of a simulation. So as I said, you've got three choices. What are you going to do to prepare for all these people who are going to visit your website by cell phone? Well, one option is you can have two sites, you know, not two URLs, but basically what you do is your home page would have two buttons on it, one that says mobile and one that says non-mobile. And then, you know, they would click on the appropriate button and they would go to a site that's optimized just for their device. Now, the pro of doing this is that, you know, people get an experience that's designed or it's optimized right for what they're using. If you've got a large computer screen and you've got a website that's going to use all that real estate, and if you've got a small smartphone screen, then you've got an experience that's not going to, you know, crowd out the little bit of screen space you have. But the problem is, most of us, and I put myself in this trap too, most of us have trouble keeping up to date the content that we have on one site, let alone now you have to duplicate everything for two different viewers. So I'm pointing that out, this is an option, you can go this route, but it's not one I would recommend. Now another option that you have is using browser detection. And by this I mean design your site primarily for desktop users. So it's designed for your laptop and desktop computers. But there are certain pages that because of the amount of content, either the number of pictures and the amount of text, are not going to view real well on a smartphone. So what you can do, if you know these languages or someone at your church does, you can use a script, JavaScript, ASP, PHP, some of these Python, that's what I was thinking of. But if you've got someone who understands these scripts, these scripting languages, you can write a small script, and it is just a few lines of code that will detect what kind of browser is coming to your website. And based on the browser, you can switch your cascading style sheets. Now, if your website uses cascading style sheets, this is pretty easy. You simply have to create a new set of style sheets that are optimized for mobile phones. So when somebody comes to a page, the script says, oh, it's a mobile phone, go use this other script, this other style sheet, not the one we normally use for our desktop. So that's how you optimize particular pages. If your website isn't using cascading style sheets, then you've got a lot of work to do because you would have to create those style sheets in the first place for your non-mobile users and then create sets of style sheets for the people who are using mobile devices on those pages you want to optimize. Which kind of takes you to our next option, is just redesign the entire site. And yes, I put ARG up there because I know some of you have just recently redesigned your site, and the idea of going through that whole process again is quite daunting. And I feel that pain. But then there are others of you who are getting ready for a redesign, so this is a perfect opportunity to look at maybe redesigning your site. Or if you haven't redesigned your site in the last 4 years, this is something you probably should be reconsidering. And what you want to do is redesign your site using WML, and that stands for Wireless Markup Language, or XHTML Mobile Profile, which is a subset of the new HTML5 standard. And just so you know, WML, the Wireless Markup Language, is a subset of HTML. So it's not like if you're coding this, you'd have to learn something completely new. You're just going to have to learn some new tags that help optimize your websites for that mobile experience. What WML or XHTML mobile profile are going to do for you? Going back to the previous slide, I talked about using scripts to detect what kind of browser is coming to your site and using a different style sheet. That's what these two languages or these two markup languages will do for you, is they detect the browser for you, so you don't have to write the scripts. And then you don't have to keep two separate style sheets. You keep one style sheet, but depending upon the type of browser that's detected, either the WML or the XHTML pull in those pieces of the WML that are applicable. They can, and then they also ignore pieces of WML that aren't applicable to, you know, the viewer experience. Some other things that if you're going to redesign your site you want to consider is reducing the number of graphics both in size and in the count of them. And by this I mean, now if you get a page that maybe has three or four pictures from, you know, a recent community outreach event or, you know, something that your church did, those kind of pictures are fine. What I'm really talking about is the huge number of small graphics that are used in the design of your site. For instance, I've seen some sites that have tabs across the top that kind of look like file folders, and you click on the tab and it takes you to different pages. Well, each of those tabs is a graphic. Your icon, your logo is a graphic. The border that goes down the left side of the screen and maybe the right side as well, those are graphics. Those are the kinds of things that we need to start paring away and eliminating. Because each of those graphics, first off, it's one more element for the mobile phone to have to interpret. And then second off, the processing time it takes to interpret those, not only what is this graphic and how do I display it, but how do I display it in relationship to all the other graphics that I'm also loading up as well. So pictures that help tell a story, those are fine, although you probably want to reduce them in size so that they fit on these smaller screens. But it's the decoration graphics that we really want to look at reducing. Also, I've got a slide coming up that helps demonstrate this next point, minimizing text and the high use of contrast, and I'll go into that in the next slide. And then the other thing is don't use Flash, which is going to cause some moans and groans for those of you who are currently using Flash, but the third most popular operating system out there is the operating system for the iPhone, which is iOS. And iOS does not display Flash. And also there are other operating systems out there that are, they have supported Flash, but they're not going to continue using it. And also, even though iOS is the third largest, it's a significant portion and it's a growing portion. So you're going to have an increasing number of people who won't be able to view your Flash images or movies or whatever it is that you have on your site. Pardon me, so those are some things you want to consider. And getting back to the text, I thought this was a great slide. We got a picture of this woman who's looking at her cell phone as she's crossing the street, which, okay, is probably not a good idea to begin with. But I brought this picture up because this is how a lot of people use their cell phones. They use them when they're on the go, they're moving. Seldomly do people sit somewhere and use their mobile phone. Now, they may be like while they're on a bus, although the bus is still in motion. Or they may be at a restaurant where, okay, they're not in motion, but they're highly distracted because you've got a waiter who's coming, or waitress, who's taking their order, bringing food, asking is everything okay, so there's constant interruptions. So you're dealing with a very short attention span there, which is not to say these people are stupid or dumb in any way, but they're just in an environment where they're constantly interrupted, so they can't focus on long pieces of text. So in preparing content for them, we need to think differently. Where websites in the past have been very focused on text with supporting graphics, we now need to be more using more often sound and motion rather than text, which is not to say we have to completely eliminate text, but again, we've got people who are on the move and they're distracted, and they're in situations where they can only view things for 3 to 5 minutes. So some things that we're going to want to look at is maybe doing more podcasting, more audio casting, because a lot of people will listen to their radio on the cell phone, they'll listen to their music on the cell phone, they're listening to, you know, some of them have digital voice recorders built in, so they're listening to things they recorded, so they're used to listening to things on their phone. So even though podcasting has kind of gone aside because, you know, with the rapid availability of video. A lot of people are switching to video instead of podcasting, but cell phones are now making it, or smartphones are making it, bringing some life back into the podcasting media. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, you can use podcasts. Certainly, we record all of our Sunday sermons. You know, we can put those out there. And yes, you can, but don't look at that as an entry point for capturing people, because again, they've got maybe 3 to 5 minutes, and they're not going to put aside time for a 20, 30, 40-minute sermon. Certainly, you can make those available, because people will be in situations where they will have time, but again, don't expect that to be a high-traffic area or an entry point into your church's website. Instead, you want short, welcoming messages, testimonies, even funny audio skits that get people laughing, because laughter, things that contain humor, go viral much faster than just about anything else out there on the internet. Pictures. Now, like I said, we can still use pictures, but we need to make sure they're shrunk down to a proper size so they view on these smaller screens. And pictures are an opportunity to maybe include a text, a caption, like at the bottom. Like if you look at newspapers, almost all the pictures have captions below them, and they can kind of tell a story for people who don't have time to read the entire article. So start looking at newspapers, how they use their photos and captions, and you can kind of emulate that in your website as well. Video, a lot of people watch video on their smartphones, and that's a great way to capture that information and put it out there for people to view. Video, I'm going to borrow a line from Willow Creek Community Church in Barrington, Illinois. If any of you have had the chance to visit them, they have just an enormous arts department. And one of their models from early on has been, the only thing worse than no drama is bad drama. So I'm going to say the same thing about video. The only thing worse than not having video is having bad video out there. And that's why 2 weeks from now, I'm going to be doing a webinar just talking about video production. In video production, it's going to be primarily geared toward, well, I'll talk about it later. Anyway, the last thing I want to talk about is PowerPoint. If you have PowerPoint 2007 or PowerPoint 2010, you have the ability to make movies by putting images and text in PowerPoint slides. And if you've got a decent microphone you can plug into your computer, you can record the timing of the slides and the timing of your voice. You can record this all together and save it as a WMV file, which is a Windows Media video file. And then you can put that out there as your video as well. So if you don't have a camera, you don't have a group of volunteers who are doing drama at your church, but you want to get some information out, PowerPoint can be an option for you as well. But again, keep the bullet points to a minimum, keep the text small. When I say small, not small in size, but small in the number of words, and make sure you incorporate photos in it as well. The last thing I want to say is about text, because again, you've got people who are primarily going to be using their phone out of doors as they transition from building to building, bus to building, from train to train, whatever. So you're going to need high contrast text. Pastel text on a white background isn't going to cut it in a high bright bright sunlight situation. So you want to stick with your high contrasting background and text. A good rule of thumb is that whatever looks good in print, the opposite looks good when it's on an illuminated surface like a projection screen, a computer screen, a smartphone screen. So I would stick with either like a pale yellow or a white or a very light gray text on a black, a dark blue, dark green, dark brown backgrounds. You can experiment with these a little bit, but again, just make sure they're high contrast. And if you have any questions, if you can, take your computer outside on a bright sunny day. Can I read it? Yes or no? And that'll tell you whether you've got the right contrast. Okay. Does your church need an app? App being short for software application. We now have the ability, we can write software programs for these smartphones. But just because you can do something doesn't mean that you should. And I'm going to talk about the reasons why here just in the next slide. Why your church would consider writing an app, and don't dismiss this idea right out of hand, because I'm going to show you that this can be affordable. But some things to think about when you write an app, decreasing order of adoption, if you come up with an application that's going to provide a unique service or a unique type of information or present it in a unique way, then you know, you've got a very high likelihood that you'll have a successful application, that it will be something that people will want. Now, related to that is what's called a mashup, where you take two different things and put them together in a new way. A great example of this is a site that used to exist called Pandora that took information from Google Maps, where people were tagging locations with information, like if you had a museum, well, a church. If you had a church, you know, you could tag it with your address, your phone number, your, you know, hours of your service on Sunday. Well, and then over here you had a website called Picasso, where you could upload photos to it. It was an early form of similar to Flickr. Well, Google purchased Picasso and then combined the photos with Google Maps and put them together, so now you could tag photos, and where you could tag geographic locations with photos. So as you looked at a map, if there were photos related, a little icon would pop up and you could click and you can see pictures of the location that was on the map. So that's a mashup. So if you've come up with an application that doesn't create any new service or any new information, but it finds a way to take two existing types of service or information and combine them together in a new way, that's almost as good as creating something, you know, brand new and unique. Now, a third option is you could recreate an existing app with better quality. And this one I kind of hesitate on because everybody has a different idea of what's better. It may be that, you know, a lot of people at your church are using a particular app on their cell phone or smartphone, and you know, they like it, but they have complaints about it. And so you've got maybe an idea of a way to, you know, put that app together in a better way. But like I said, it's very subjective what's better or not. So you really need to look at this objectively and determine, are we really going to provide something better that works faster, that's smarter, that's cheaper, or are we just going to provide more of the same? Now, what does it cost to, let's look at where would you want to develop applications? Like I said, if you see the large blue section, this is the Symbian operating system as a share of the market. Symbian is an operating system that came out with the Nokia cell phones and was adopted by several other platforms. Nokia is dropping its support of Symbian starting next year, and they're switching to, well, not dropping the support, but they're phasing it out, and they're going to the Windows Mobile operating system. So in the next couple of years, you're going to see that big blue chunk of the pie shrink rapidly, and then you're going to see the Windows Mobile operating system piece grow. Maybe not quite so rapidly, because the green and yellow sections here, the Android market, which is produced by Google, and then the Apple operating system produced by Apple, are also growing at increasing rates. So if you're going to develop an app, those would be the platforms you want to develop for first, and then look at others later. The red section there, RIM, Reality in Motion, this is the operating system for BlackBerries. Still very popular. It has not gained or lost any ground over the last 2 years in terms of percentage of market share, so it's still a very viable operating system, but probably not your first choice unless, you know, that's the phone that your church uses. How much does it cost to develop an application for your church? There are some sites out there that use templated methods where you basically just drag and drop pieces of code in and create a new application. I say this can be done for less than $1,000, but that would be, you know, with all the bells and whistles that these sites provide. It's very possible that some of these sites you can create an application for as little as $300. But again, it's going to be up to you to figure out, you know, is that money that's well spent, or should we spend our $300 on something else? Just to let you know, we've got thunder and lightning here, so if I get cut off in the middle, it means we've lost power in the house. So anyway, now another option, if these templated sites aren't going to work for you, you can go to a freelancer. There's meetup.com, elance.com, there's a whole bunch of other sites out there you can look up, where you can hire programmers. You can say, this is the application we want to develop, this is what we want it to do, we want it to do it for this platform, and here's our budget. And they can bid on these things and say, yes, it can do that, and you know, you can look at all the prospective bidders and decide whether or not you're going to hire them. Another option, which is, I just thought I'd put it out here for fun, but if you want to hire a dedicated marketing company, they have developers who can do this. Beginning entry point is $20,000. For most companies, they're looking at like $150,000 and up to develop an application. So most of you, I know we certainly don't have budget for that. Another option is if you get a staff person or a volunteer who knows the C-sharp programming language or Java, which are popular languages, and if you've got even a medium-sized congregation, you probably have people who know these languages. They might be willing to develop these applications for you just as a fun project. But as most of you know, the downside of having a staff or volunteer person do this is that staff people have other responsibilities, and it's a shocker, but volunteers have lives of their own. They have soccer games to take their kids to. They have lawns to mow. They have bills to pay. They've got, you know, family obligations. So it may take a while to get your app developed. But you know, if time is not critical for you and they're willing to do it for free or even very minimal cost, that could be an option. So, last thing I'm going to say about apps is how you're going to promote it. Now, if it's strictly for use by your congregation, then your normal methods of promotion are going to work. Your website, your Sunday bulletin, these kinds of things are fine. If you're going to develop an app for outside of your church, at that point, all the scales are the same. Whether you're talking about an app that applies only to your community or applies to the entire world, the marketing strategy and budget are pretty much the same then. And I want to emphasize that if you're going to have a global app, that you need a marketing strategy, not marketing tactics. Putting stuff in your bulletin, on your website, maybe taking an ad in the local paper, those are all tactics. I'm not going to go into marketing strategy because that's more than one webinar just to discuss that. But also you need to think if you're going to download it from your website, that's fine, but if you're going to upload it to either the Apple Store or the Android Store or some of these other online stores, you need to pay to get it up there. You're going to have to give them a royalty, which can be up to 30% of your sales. And then you're also going to have to promote it because they're not going to promote it for you. So you're looking at an investment here, and you have to figure out what is going to be the return on your investment. Are you looking to get your money back? Are you looking at the number of conversions? Are you looking at the number of people who are going to be involved in your community now? So these are all things you need to consider if you're going to go with a global strategy. So my last topic here I want to talk about is QR codes. And like I said, these are exciting things. QR stands for quick response codes. And I would really encourage all of you, sometime this week, make some time, do some research, and start deploying these things. Because what this is, you're looking at a QR code. It's a square barcode. And I've got a slide here with some links to websites where you can generate these things. So you just go in and you type what you want, and it generates a QR code for you for free. Now, what a QR code does, anybody who has a smartphone with a QR code reader takes a picture of the QR code, and your cell phone decodes the information and presents it to you. Now, every operating system out there has at least three, if not more. I think the most I saw was for RIM. The RIM operating system has like seven different readers you can download for free to put in your cell phone. Any of the cell phones that have been shipping since mid-2010 should have a QR code reader already installed in it for free. So you take a picture of this QR code, and it can display a text message, it can display a picture, it can be a link to a website, anything that you can do with your website or email in terms of sending links to people, you can do with a QR code, except that it's as simple now as taking a picture. So I think they're really neat. Some top uses for QR codes. I did some searching on the internet, and I've got, you can go back to the presentation later, but I've got these three websites that talk about different uses for QR codes. I pulled out some of the common ones that I saw going through these and some other websites that I was reading. But here's one of our early call-ins. We talked about Sunday bulletins, and we talked about some churches going paperless. What you can do is print up a QR code on like just a letter-sized sheet of paper and post it outside your sanctuary. So as people walk in, they can take a picture of the QR code with their cell phone, and as they're sitting in the pew, instead of reading a paper bulletin, they could be reading a PDF bulletin that you've formatted specifically for the cell phone. Because again, just like we talked about in that other call-in, don't just take your paper bulletin and save it as a PDF and put it on your website. Make sure you format it specifically for people to view on their computer or their cell phone. Another thing you can do is create a QR code that's a link to last week's sermon if you post your sermons on your website. If the podcast or if it's notes or if it's even a video, you can have links to all of that. You can have a link to this week's upcoming calendar. And these two bullets here, talking about last week's sermon and this week's calendar, these QR codes can be pretty much any size. Now, small, you don't want to go smaller than a half inch height and width. But there are companies who are putting QR codes on the side of their building. So a thought for you is to create a web page on your site that has maybe, it has a link to this week's sermon. It has a list of this week's events. So this would be a page you'd have to update weekly. And then make a QR code just for that page and put that QR code out by the road sign of your church. So as people drive by, they not only see the road sign for your church, but they can take the picture of it and find out what's going on at your church. This is really great, especially if you're in a high traffic area. Like I know Ward Presbyterian in Livonia, Michigan, they're on 6 Mile Road, which is a 7-lane road, 3 in each direction with a turn lane. Very busy roads. A lot of people go by Ward Church. Even the smaller church I go to, Faith EPC in Rochester Hills, we don't get a lot of traffic by there throughout the day, but early in the morning and then late in the afternoon when people are going to and from work, this road we're on is a main artery for people to get from the main road to their subdivisions. So again, great opportunity if you're in a high traffic area. Another thought is you can link to a V-card. And I'm sorry, I'm throwing a lot of technology at you today in a lot of terms. A V-card is a virtual business card. It's the if you store your contacts on your cell phone or if you store your contacts in your Microsoft Outlook, all of these contacts are stored in the V-card format. And you can search online for V-card generator and you'll find a bunch of websites that allow you to type in, your business information, your phone number, your email address, and whatever else you want to put in about you. And you can take these V-cards and you can upload them as text files to your website. And then you can make a link directly to that file, not to the page it's on, but make a link directly to the directory where this V-card is stored. So now you can take that the QR code, print it on your business card. When you hand someone your business card, they can read your phone number and your email address. But they can also take a picture with their cell phone, and the information gets immediately stored right in your cell phone. They don't have to type it in, and they don't have to mistype it in. My wife and I operate an adoption assistance foundation. Actually, she operates it. I just kind of help behind the scenes. And I saw this, and we right away printed up new business cards that had these QR codes on them. And she went to a conference, and people just thought these were the greatest things since sliced bread, that they could just immediately get her contact information and just put it in there. By the way, minor plug, if you're looking for someone to speak on adoption assistance and foster care issues, get a hold of my wife. I'll give you one of her business cards. Anyway, so and the other links here you can look at later. This one has 101 uses for QR codes. It's not church or nonprofit specific, so there's a lot of business, for-profit type thoughts, but it might give you some thoughts as well. And I would be really interested to hear how all of you are using QR codes as you begin to deploy them in and around your church. I got to believe there's a way to use them in children's ministry. I just haven't figured out how yet. So if any of you come up with a great idea for QR codes in children's ministries, please let me know right away. Here's the links to the QR code generators. Again, you can do a search for a QR code generator. These are four that I've tried out, and I really like them. They're all slightly different. They offer a little different options in terms of what they produce. So go ahead and try these out and see what you think of them. Just real quick about QR codes. Now, they're not meant to store a lot of information, generally up to 75 characters. So whatever business card information or text message or website link you can get in 75 characters, you can put more information in them than that. You can create very dense QR codes, but the denser you create the QR code, the steadier needs to be the hand of the person taking the picture and the higher the resolution of the camera. So if you know you're going to be working with people who've got the latest, 10 megapixel cameras built into their phone and they've got a tripod stand that they carry around with them, you can count on them to be able to get the information out of your QR code. But for most people, you probably want to stick with the low density 75 character QR codes to make sure that they get everything. Okay, wrap up. We talked about mobile industry, how it's on its way here, that internet access via mobile devices is going to exceed desktops here within a year to a year and a half. We talked about some of the reasons why we need to get our websites prepared for mobile viewing and some of the things we need to consider in doing that. We talked about developing apps for your church and the cost related to that. We talked about why QR codes are the greatest thing since sliced bread, my opinion. Some homework. What I'd like you to do is do a 3-week survey in your church sometime to figure out just, you know, whether your church is going to be ready for the mobile revolution when it gets here or not. Just ask people 3 simple questions. First off, do you own a cell phone of some type? If you don't, that's useful to know that. But if you do, we want to know, does it have internet access? You know, do you just use your cell phone for calling and pictures? Or do you access, is this your primary point of access to the internet? Then also, how many people are you actively trying to invite to our church that use a cell phone that accesses the internet? And that may be difficult to get that information because there's a lot of variables there. You try to invite people to your church that you run into on a regular basis, neighbors, family, coworkers, that kind of thing. But how many of them are you actively inviting on a semi-regular basis to come to your church? And of those people, do you know, do they use a cell phone, a smartphone, and do they access the internet with it? Because, again, as part of your mobile strategy is, you know, making sure that we're ready for these people. And also making sure that these are the people we're trying to reach. Because if you're primarily reaching out to people who don't access the internet through their mobile device, then this needs to be a lower priority than some of your other promotional efforts. And then other thing we want to look at too is other homework assignment is brainstorming with your team. How can you use QR codes in your ministry? Are there other creative ways besides putting something out by the road? Are there things that we can do in our church to help people navigate our church, to help understand our church, to help get involved in our church? Is there some other way we can use these QR codes? Other homework, make sure you invite someone else to join us. Again, thank you to all of you who have invited somebody else to join us for these call-ins and to join us on EPC Community for our discussions there. If you haven't invited somebody, please do so. We want to try to reach out to everybody. And some of you probably saw the email I sent out. I'm trying to find out where all of you are located because I want to find out where around the country we're getting reach with our webinars in EPC Community and where we're not. So if you can please email me and let me know where your church is located so I can figure out where we need to focus our efforts in reaching out to people and getting them involved. And then again, if you've got a Facebook page, a Twitter page, if your pastor tweets or someone on staff, let me know. I just found 3 pastors today that I've added to our account because we want to make sure we're following all of you and keeping up with what's going on. Okay, with that, everybody, I'm going to stick around till 1 o'clock. This is the question and answer time, so if you've got questions or if you want me to go back over something in more detail, just go ahead and fire away. I've got everybody unmuted, so if you've got a question, unmute your phone and ask away. Like I said, I'll hang on here till 1 o'clock or until everybody's hung up on me.
Hi, Dana. Thank you. This is all new to me.
Okay, great.
My question is, you talked about adapting your PDFs for mobile. I missed that lecture. Can you tell me when you did that, what the name of it was?
Sure. That was our second call-in. That was back in February. If you go to Vimeo.com, let's see, Vimeo.com/channels/EPC. Vimeo, Vimeo.com/channels/EPC. And that has all of the presentations that have been recorded and uploaded. You want to look for the one on Sunday bulletins. Because I interviewed two of the ladies in our community here, graciously let me interview them, and they talked about how instead of just taking your paper bulletin and converting it, you know, saving it as a PDF, you really need to take the information from the Sunday bulletin and reformat it differently so it views differently on your computer monitor.
Okay, I guess I did hear that. So you were suggesting not use a PDF or just change the PDF to text only?
What I'm suggesting is that, go ahead and use the PDF, but just make sure that if you're going to send people on a mobile phone to a PDF, that the PDF is formatted so that it views well on those mobile phones. So that way they don't have to do a lot of scrolling around.
Okay, thanks.
And one way that might, facilitate that is to have a table of contents for your Sunday bulletin. A lot of bulletins kind of read like newspapers where, it's just column of text after column of text broken up by headlines. And you may want to have a table of contents so it's easy for people to, quickly get to the information that's of interest to them. Okay, thanks. Great question. Who was this?
This is Liz.
Liz, okay, hi. I'm still not recognizing everybody by voice yet. I'm sorry.
I still have a frog in my throat anyway. You wouldn't know my voice.
Okay. All right. That's a good question. Who else? Let's see here. All right, like I said, I'm going to hang around here till 1 o'clock, so if it's taking a while to percolate a thought, go ahead and take some time.